man invented the wheel, our very lives have depended upon wheels, travel, and transportation. Early Americans, hardy pioneers, men and women of courage and ambition broke the untamed plains to the rumble of wheels. Wheels carried their families and all their earthly possessions westward, ever westward. Wheels were the lifeline of the West, and always there was the law of the frontier. The man who holds the roads and mountain passes rules an empire.
The Merry Pranksters rejected the normative conceptualization of the American frontier by traveling east instead of west and embarking upon a journey of countercultural resistance that would forever alter the country's social and political landscape.
Say the Joker to the thief. There's too much confusion. I can't get no relief.
The Merry Pranksters were a group of friends and followers of American author Ken Kesey, known for their liberal use of psychedelic drugs and their refusal to observe standard cultural practices. But before their cross-country road trip and a colorfully painted school bus, they were members of a social and literary movement known as the Beat Generation. The Beat Generation was defined by its spiritual quest to rediscover American identity, apart from economic materialism and a dependence upon social conformity, as well as their endorsement of exploration regarding sexuality and substances. In 1960, after going to graduate school and studying creative writing at Stanford University, Ken Kesey, generally considered by historians as the unofficial leader of the Merry Pranksters, began writing one of America's most recognizable novels, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. The book was loosely based upon Kesey's own experience with psychedelic drugs while he was a student at Stanford. Kesey was paid to participate in an illegal government-sponsored study that examined the effects of drugs like lysergic acid diethylamide, commonly known as LSD, through human experimentation. This program, designed and organized by the Central Intelligence Agency, was known as MKUltra, and its existence was not officially disclosed to the general public until 1975. The publication of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest in 1962 sparked many important conversations about the rights of Native Americans, economic exploitation, and the deinstitutionalization of mentally ill patients inside the country's healthcare system. But it was also commercially successful, providing Kesey with the resources needed to purchase a 1939 International Harvester school bus in order to accommodate a large group of individuals that come to be known as the Merry Pranksters during their cross-country road trip from San Francisco to New York City. In 1964, since Kesey needed to be present on the East Coast for the publication of his second novel, he devised a plan to bring along a group of artists, authors, and companions during his journey. Kesey wanted to film their adventures and ultimately create a road movie inspired by the 1957 novel On the Road, written by Jack Kerouac, another prominent Merry Prankster. The formation of the Merry Pranksters was not a new development in Kesey's personal life. As Mike Peters writes in Highbrow Magazine, tested out fictionally in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest through the protagonist McMurphy's various attempts to upstage Nurse Ratchet and challenge her authority, pranking became a way of creating events that disrupt conventional routines and forms of hierarchical control in a highly conformist society. But the pranksterism practiced by Kesey and his group of friends was obviously a form of politics inaccessible to those without some level of social power. It is almost precisely because of their position in society that their message was so powerful. Just as with the hippies who came later, it was unfathomable that a group of promising, white, middle-class kids from California could throw away their life in favor of a cross-country road trip. Soon enough, the Beat Generation's once conceptual movement that sought to disrupt and disturb American society was put onto wheels and actualized itself through a complete transformation of traditional imagery and experiences associated with the American West. Indeed, the group's travels from west to east, as opposed to the other way around, marked a significant historical turning point in the movement of both individuals and ideas throughout history. Kesey was convinced that the effects of LSD constituted an unexplored social territory, and wanted to expose the east to what the west had discovered decades ago, the powerful potential of psychedelic drugs. As professor and American historian Dominic Cavallo writes, the purpose of this bus trip was to see what might happen when spontaneous behavior inspired by hallucinogenic drugs confronted what Kesey saw as the dreary conformity and dismal rationality of American society. Additionally, the terminology of tripping, both on acids and American roads, creates a duality within the historical legacy offered by the Merry Pranksters, exemplifying both the radicalism shown through their use of psychedelic drugs, as well as their co-option of the all-American inclination to travel in order to discover something new. The Pranksters refurbished their bus, adding speakers, seating, and splashing both the interior and exterior of the vehicle with a coat of psychedelic paint colors that were meant to showcase the group's collective values. Furthur was both the name of their vehicle as well as its destination. During the road trip, the group made documented stops in many cities, including San Jose, Los Angeles, Phoenix, Houston, New Orleans, and Pensacola. Many of these detours called for intense acid trips that tested the ability of even the most experienced users. During their two-month adventure, they played music, games, and enjoyed each other's company while supposedly accessing a spiritual awakening that could only be attributed to drugs. Each prankster also adopted a unique nickname that spoke to their true identity, which could only be revealed through the use of LSD. These included Intrepid Traveler, Hardly Visible, Stark Naked, Malfunction, Zonkers, and Highly Charged. Kesey was known as the Navigator, and Neil Cassidy, the group's primary driver, was called Sir Speed Limit. The bus ultimately serves as a highly visible symbol of America's cultural shift that occurred in the late 60s, and it is truly an artifact of activism led by members of the Merry Pranksters. Upon returning to California and using money made from his book sales, Kesey then purchased a home in La Honda, California, located in the Santa Cruz Mountains near the San Francisco Bay, where he began to entertain new friends and host large house parties.
Why don't you guys come?
These gatherings grew to become known as the acid tests and were well documented in a number of primary sources, most notably Tom Wolfe's 1968 book, The Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test. Many members of the Beat Generation, including Kesey, Neil Cassidy, Jack Kerouac, and Allen Ginsberg, played a critical role in organizing these events. They often included multimedia performances, such as spoken word poetry and music played by bands like the Grateful Dead, who were in attendance at most of Kesey's house parties. These events were soon organized in public spaces, and drugs like LSD were distributed to willing participants who wanted to experience the liberatory potential of the new drug. As a result of the grassroots experimentation with acid that was organized by Kesey and other members of the Beat Generation, LSD began to act as a unifying force that empowered countercultural movements which were eager to speak out against dominant political and social institutions. The state of California outlawed the use of LSD in 1966. Also in 1966, Ken Kesey was charged with illegal possession of marijuana, and in order to avoid the prison sentence that would have been required under California law, Kesey and the other Merry Pranksters designed an elaborate plot in order to escape law enforcement. They composed a fake suicide note that suggested Kesey drove himself off a cliff in Northern California, while in actuality, the author fled to Mexico and assumed a new identity. But just a year later, Kesey returned to California and served a six-month sentence in the San Mateo County Jail. He then moved back to his home state of Oregon, where he would remain until his death in 2001. The movement didn't die in 1966, however, and the Merry Pranksters ultimately inspired an entire generation of young people who were discouraged by violence, war, and racial discrimination that existed at the time. In 1967, San Francisco saw a surge of social energy during the Summer of Love, and the individuals who engaged in these activities came to be known as the hippies. They strongly opposed the Vietnam War and endorsed the use of things like LSD, which almost certainly would not have been possible without the existence of the Merry Pranksters, who served as both a physical and political transition between the Beat Generation and the hippie movement. Beginning in the West, the final destination for pioneers who had pushed across the continent before, while also initiating their own exploration of America's cultural landscape, the Merry Pranksters radically redefined how historians analyze the frontier. When we search for an articulation of our collective identity, images of westward expansion appear. The frontier was once understood as a site of conquest where Americans traveled to impose their will upon the land and its people. It was a place of domination and control, and it is celebrated as such in American culture. However, the Pranksters offered another perspective, viewing the open road not as a place of conquest, but as a space of experimentation, rejecting the idea that the frontier must be managed, instead embracing its unpredictability. The Merry Pranksters rearticulated its meaning by embarking upon their own journey, traveling further into the psychedelic 60s.